Biff's Gaming Videos. Joysticks and joypads.
Trackballs and mouse pads.
Spinners and light guns.
Fun.
Alien invasions.
Robotic invasions.
Dungeons and dragons.
Fun.
Home runs and touchdowns.
Jungles and ghost towns.
Videos from Biff's son.
Fun.
This is the 2019 Free Play Florida, held in Orlando, Florida, around Thanksgiving at the Caribe Royale Hotel Convention Center and Resort. As you come in here, you'll see that it's a video game and pinball expo. Now, as I shot some of this, there wasn't that many people so I could show things. So later on, they'll be packed, particularly on Saturday. You take a look around, there's lots of things to do, things to play, things to buy. There are panels to show and all sorts of really cool stuff. This is the pre-war playground. It's pre-World War II pinball machines. Now, if you saw my video from last year, 2018, I have an interview with the gentleman who owns all this. It's really cool. This is stuff that goes back and say, wow, is this really pinball? Is this what it's like? If you take a look at it, there aren't any flashing electronic kind of mumbo jumbo. This is the earliest video. These are like super ancient, like nobody has this kind of stuff. And to be able to go to something like this and to see pinball games like this is awesome. I mean, just to show someone, hey, this is history. Before all the fun and all the excitement of video games, this is what people did before World War II to actually have fun in their own particular arcades. Let's take a quick walk around. This guy right here is the Tron Recognizer. In the very middle of the convention floor, they had this Tron area. If you take a look around, they had the Tron arcade video game, which is really cool, one of my all-time favorites. They had posters, and there was beach towels, and they had a video game, Tron 2.0, over here. Now, if you've never played Tron 2.0 on the PC, get it and watch the cutscenes, because it gives you all this extra video, almost like a mini movie that makes a lot more sense for Tron Legacy. And for some reason or other, had the Gorf in there as well. They also had pinball over in the corner. Now, pinball and video games were both represented in this event, but I tell you, the pinball people are like hardcore types. I mean, they are just like fanatics. They love pinball. They still make pinball games today. Not many of them, but this one is Tron Legacy, and it shows that it can still be fun playing pinball if you know that. Now, the Tron video game, this one had four different games. This is in PC, the Master Control Program. If you take a look, it comes to the main menu, it pops over there, and then you can do light cycles. Well, there was a fifth game that couldn't get in this game because they didn't have enough memory or whatever. So they made it Discs of Tron. I remember some of the arcade down the road from where I live. If you take a look at it, it's got like a 3D kind of looking thing where he jumps on discs. And it's a monstrosity where you just walk in there. They also had a blindfolded Pac-Man game where the gentleman putting the mask on could not see the game. But over to the left, the gentleman would tell him go up, down, left, right. So let's just see how long this guy would go to see what kind of score he goes. So ready? Here we go. And go! Boom! He's dead. Oh my god, so fast. There's a giant Donkey Kong game where there's a stool and you have to stand on the stool and go over there and play Donkey Kong. And they had some giant games here too. Sometimes you see these events, they have different ones like that. There's a Star Wars, so you have to use the Force to be able to get up that high. It's a giant Star Wars machine, right? But it was really, really cool. No one has something like this anywhere, so you got to use the Force on this one. Han Solo had his own little corner over here where he was frozen in carbonite. No one could mess with him because, you know, Darth Vader wanted him in carbonite. Apparently, superheroes get to play pinball too. They like it. Here's Spider-Man is over there playing, and here you got Iron Man playing too. Let's see if he can look. He has a tough time looking through the mask. Oh man, to be able to see the pinball. That sucks, right? Sorry, dude. Over here is Angry Video Game Nerd. James Rolfe. He had a little booth there. He'd taken it. Yeah, how are you doing? I know you. You're the guy with double poopy jokes. Billy Mitchell was here from King of Kong, the documentary that was done. Now, he has a machine that he's selling for $1,400. And you can also see he's got a bunch of chairs there that he sits on, gets up a little high. Now, he MCs too, I guess. He gets up on stage and, you know, a lot of these guys are fairly good at talking in front of an audience, and he was too, and blah, 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 blah there. A lot of these places have these arts and crafts for kids so they can make little things. They have like these little patterns and they make them. It's a fun little thing for young kids. And who's at the top right of the screen there? Oh, wait, look at this. You got some kapunas to be able to wear a shirt like this in public. Now, I want you to take a look at the word at the top right of his shoulder. It's B-I-F-F-F. Oh, he spelled it wrong, dude. There was a conference area as well, a panel room. This is Activision guys. The far right is David Crane, and the other two guys are the Kitchens. And they helped found Activision, a lot of the games from Action. So they had all these during the day, hour after hour after hour, they had a lot of panels that you can go and watch. Now let's take a look at some of the skill type games. This obviously is foosball. Now, I love skill games. Ice hockey, the USA, USSR one, air hockey, I cannot be defeated. I'm really good at this game too. Boom, it's in there, you know it, baby. Yeah, get it. And when I worked at Chuck E. Cheese Showbiz Pizza Place back in the day, we had, not this one, but a ball game. And what they used to do is take the basketball and they would put it underneath the bar so the bar would never close, so the basketballs kept falling underneath. But this was like an X and O tic-tac-toe kind of game, which is kind of neat for the kids. Sure, why not? I love this one. This is a four-player air hockey. I cannot be defeated at air hockey. I'm so good at it. I used to play it all the time at every single day when I was at a Showbiz Pizza Place in college. But a four-player one, it looks really, really, really cool. Gravity Hill is a little game where you move left and right on this handlebar, and you've got this ball that you have to move, and no one ever gets far in this. When it goes down, or whatever, it's over. Meltdown is an awesome game. It looks really cool. It's got that blue light laser looking thing, and you've got a ball, and you have to move it up. And these skill games, they're not meant for you really to finish them. They're actually meant for you to keep putting quarters in over more and more and more. But this was kind of a cool game. Ice Cold Beer. This is actually a fan favorite. Every year there's always people playing this game. You got a ball and you have to move it up to the top. No one ever. I've never seen anyone get to the top, but you can try. Keep putting more and more money in. But this is a really popular game. I'm shocked that I don't see this more just anywhere, just in the arcades, wherever, in the movie theater or the bar. But this is a kind of fun game. Ice Cold Beer. This is a Disneyland, even though we're in Orlando and it's Disney World. This is a Disneyland mold maker that the guy was fixing there. This was a huge fan favorite. There was always, always, always a line of kids wanting to do this, like 5-6 at a time all weekend long. And I guess it came from Disneyland, but that's kind of a cool looking thing to be able to show off at an invention like this. Now, over across the hall, there was a room dedicated for the pinball tournament. It was a lot, lot quieter. Oh, yeah, so you can take a look at this. Oh, nice and quiet. I love it. So you go in here, and every single one of these guys is a fanatic. I'm telling you, these guys love pinball. And the deal is that they would compete against other people on these machines, and so there's like, I don't know how many, like 30 or 40 of these going on at the same time. This guy had that bar over it, which his cameras were recording what he was doing. As you go around, you'll start to notice little twerks of people like hitting the machines, jumping up and down, all types of crazy stuff. You don't seriously see that as much as you do on video games, but this guy's got a glove on. I mean, that's how hardcore these guys are. But you know what? Oh, hey, yeah, he's got to raise his hand. Yeah, that me. I like got knocked out. So when someone gets knocked out, they raise a hand, guy goes over there, records his score, and then what's this guy? This guy, he's got it going on here. He's like, And he's got to do the whole Eric. Apparently, that makes the ball move or something. I don't know. And as the event went on, they had awards the last day. And this was actually kind of, if I was in the pinball, I would be here the whole weekend. So people that are in the pinball, they were in this room. So this is the pinball tournament area. This is the consoles and computers, or old consoles and old computers area, that was in this corner of the main convention center hall. This particular one is probably the most one that they played the most, because they all had like guitars and drums and all that. And as I go around, you'll see all these systems, and these are owned by different people. There's Xbox and Dreamcast, and that looks like a Sega 32X with a Sega CD somewhere, and 3DO, Nintendo 64. So as you go around, you can sit down and play these games. Now, maybe people weren't born when the Sega Master System was there, or that looks like an Atari 7800 over in the corner. So you can sit down and actually play something like Asteroids on the Atari VCS, which is something really cool. Now, if that was your favorite game, you can play that, and they have people throw out cartridges there for people to play. And on the other half of the section, they had more. Now, this stuff had even older games. And if you take a look at them, you're like, what are these things? Now, I've had basically everything, except over in the corner, the Commodore PET and the one to the right of it. I didn't have those, but I basically had all the other ones. And if you take a look around, you'll notice there's a progression of games, and I guess mostly games. I mean, if you want to play text games, you can play text games. You can play Donkey Kong, or you can play some type of SNK type game over here. It doesn't matter. There was something there for anybody. And something I noticed is that people would sit down and play their favorite games, and they would stay on those games because that's what they wanted. So even like in the arcades, let's say you were into the Qbert or whatever, people would go to the games that they liked. So on these here, this gentleman, he loved MacDog McCree, and he sat down and, hey, I'm going to play that game, because that's what they're into. Not necessarily the systems. And so they could bounce around. So it's not just to show your kids, hey, this is what the games are like, but you could actually play them. So maybe you didn't have a particular system today. Let's say you didn't have an Apple Mac. Well, you can go there and play an Apple Mac game. Now, this is a really, really, really rare system here. And if you just wanted to see what it was like, hey man, check this system out. And you could actually touch it and play with it. And over here is Doom. It had it was a table with four chairs and those Doom hosts. And you could sit down and play Doom on the keyboard and mouse, which I hate playing with the keyboard and mouse, but you could play Doom against more people if you wanted to. Atari VCS, looks like Pitfall 2, The Lost Caverns. You can sit down and have a blast there, and something that I'm sure he's not that old. And there's an Atari, it looks like a 7800 with Joust. These games, like right here, you have to be into that kind of stuff. So I see these guys playing this all weekend long. Seriously, I don't know who brought these in, but certain people bring them in, and certain people just play them all the time.
There's 8 billion games in here, and you pick Klondike.
Solitaire?
Yeah.
It's the essential Windows experience. You can't use Windows without using Solitaire.
This is the indie video game developers area. You could come and meet the developers, the designers, the guy who programmed the games, right? And you could sit down, play. You could tell them what you like, what you don't like. I like this. I don't like the controller. This sucks. This is great. And they can learn from you. Now here is Jungles of Mexteria. You can see the purple ribbon in the middle there. This won a one-up award. They went around and gave out awards to different developers and different people and different things throughout the weekend. This was done by an independent group of people from Byte Entertainment, the ones who set up the event. But this particular game is a 2D side-scrolling platformer game where you go through the jungles looking for lost treasure. Now, if it was me, I would put the treasure in a vault, in a bank. But apparently in video games you don't do that. So it was a kind of a finished game that they were showing off. Nano is another 1UP award winner. This is, I guess you're going to call it a 3D isometric action type game. These guys came up from Miami to show off their game. It's very early on here, but the reason is you want to give out your business cards and you want to get a support for your game so people can follow along on your website or Facebook or whatever. So when a game comes out, they can tell their friends and go buy it. This game is Oink. These guys came up from Tampa. And an Oink, you have a naked pig for some reason, and you go around a 3D world and you collect stuff. And there's the bad guys are like mooses and giant rats and differing farm characters. And it's another very early on prototype that they were showing off here at the event. Cosmotrons is a newer arcade game, and these guys came in from out of state. I think they're from Minnesota or wherever, but they came and they showed off their arcade game here. It's a multiplayer space battle kind of fun game. They don't really make arcade games anymore, but it's really nice to see an occasional one like this. This is an indie game. I mean, it's really cool. Over here is Highlight Heroes. This is a multiplayer game, and for those of you who don't know what Highlight is, it's kind of like racquetball or handball, where you take the ball and you throw it up against the wall and it comes back and you can play on teams. It's actually a gambling game in Florida. It's very big in different areas. So in South Florida, it's big. Floppy and the Sleepy Planet is another indie game. And this one is a 3D game where you play with Mr. Floppy from that old TV show, I guess. But no, I'm just joking. Mr. Floppy goes around and he does stuff. My generic game does stuff in the world, the 3D world. It actually looked kind of cool. They've been working on it for a long time, and it's fairly far along, and it looks kind of cool. Floppy and the Sleepy Planet. Indienomicon is a group where independent video game developers get to go, and they have meetings like every month. And you can show off your video games and talk about stuff, and they have meetings. This particular game was done at a game jam over one weekend, and they're playing, it's a multiplayer game, but Indienomicon is a good place to go for independent video game developers. Back in the day, people played pinball. Before video games, there were pinball machines. And if you take a look at the big, long, wide shot of the main room here, you'll see that there's a lot of pinball people, almost like more than the video game people. These guys are fanatics, and they have certain games that they like. Big Brave. If you take a look at it, it's like a really old game. So people fixate on certain game that they like. Maybe it was a game that they had when they were a kid at the local convenience store or the local bar or whatever. So you wonder, why are they playing such old games? It's like, well, this is something that they're into. There are newer games, and there are very new games. But I just thought it was really fascinating to see people playing the same game for a long period of time. Now, some people will go around and play different games because this is an opportunity not only to show off the games, but to sell them, because a lot of these games are for sale. You'll see, like, these for sale stickers on the side, and they're trying to, like, bring them in, get rid of them during the event, which is, that's fine. But when you're playing them, it's more something you, I mean, it's like some people that play chess. They love playing chess. People like playing pinball. And this is a good place to see different ones like this here. I've never seen, this is the entertainer one where you look down on the pinball game. That's kind of cool, neat little concept. So you get to see stuff like this. I mean, where else are you gonna go? I mean, there's very few places now that have pinball machines and video games together like this. And it's such a huge event. And let me tell you, these guys come in here, and this is Game of Thrones to the right, so there are very new games. And this is Dialed In, which is a game with cell phones and stuff. I mean, that tells you how new these are. But let me tell you, these guys come in, and they will play every second they can. They'll be lined up at the front, waiting to play. And then they'll go right to the very end of the night when they get kicked out. And then, of course, there's the pinball tournament, too. So a lot of these guys will go over and play the pinball tournament for a while and then come back. And I mean, I'm not really into pinball, but I could see how you can get fixated on something like this. You like something like Terminator or Avengers. You're into that kind of stuff. There you go. You come and you can show the kids, hey, this is what it used to be when I was a kid. And there was just a huge variety of games. And then there are places like the Pinball Museum in Las Vegas that has a bunch of stuff like this. And here's the monkeys. Here they come. They walk down the street. Oh, it's the Beatles. Like, sorry. That's right. Had the guy from Star Trek was on it. Right. Check off. He was in the monkeys. So, Bonsai Run. Lots of neat artwork, too. Wow, you look at the artwork on some of this. It's amazing. Pinball machines for you. So as you go through this, this is more of the same. You just pick the game that you like. You don't have to put any quarters in. It's a club Free Play Florida now. And when you get a high score, you bring out the cell phone, you take a picture. Hey, I did that. Cool. Now, you can't go to one of these events without coming across people that want to hawk their goods. Now, a lot of this stuff is used, a lot of stuff. A lot of it has no packaging, but the stuff that really sells is stuff with packaging. At an event like this, you'll get tons and tons and tons of video game stuff, CDs, cartridges. If you're looking for video game stuff, this is actually a good place. I mean, the DJ Station Pro and stuff like that. And you can get this on the internet, obviously, of course. But here you can actually go through the bins and see what you like, and you might come across something at a good price. You know, right here, it's $5 each or 5 for 20. So doing the math, that's $4 each. See, I can divide 5 into the 20, that's 4. There are things like, these are cups. here's what's even cooler. You get to actually meet the people that do this kind of stuff. They make these things. Now, sometimes they resell them, but You meet the designers, the artists, which is really cool. This is an area that has little plush dolls and things, and obviously they didn't make the things in the boxes, but who knows what they made. So you can come and get stuff for the kids. You know, this is Thanksgiving time, and buttons. Now, kids like buttons, I guess, and they can actually make buttons while you're there. If you take a look at the very end here, after this James Bond thing, that's the button maker there, so you can see them making the button if you want to. Pillows, purses, comic books, I mean, you name it. You come in, now the main theme of this stuff is more video games, but there are movies and comics. WKRP Turkey Drought, that's a great episode. So there's other themes going on other than just video games, particularly sci-fi like Star Wars. You see a lot of that kind of stuff. You see Mortal Kombat there. And the artists, t-shirts and posters and all kinds of stuff. And there'll be a person sitting there that actually designed this. I mean, how cool is that? Where else are you going to meet the artists who did this kind of stuff? And they think it's kind of cool if you walk in and start seeing an interest in what they've done. I mean, why not? Right now, there are magazines too, and obviously they didn't do the magazines. But if you're selling it at a comic book store, that's a good place to sell this kind of stuff. And the monsters, you know, with Uma Thurman there. That's her Pidmo game, sure. Why not? And of course, you have things like t-shirts. Lots and lots of t-shirts. You can pick whatever you want. And they have a video game theme or a sci-fi theme or whatever theme that you want. Now, this is the big stuff. This is the most people came for the video, unless you're into pinball. Lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of arcade stuff. Video games were big for a lot of years, and if you take a look at them, there were video games or stuff to sell, and then there's pinball. So we're gonna go through this section of the video games, and I'm gonna show you a neat trick and how to get a really high score. Take a look at a little girl on the right, now she's playing this game with her dad, and apparently you have to jump up and down, and the faster you do it, and the higher and the more giggly you get, the higher the score is. So she's kicking higher. Do it. Good times. Now look at these kids, man. They're going. Look at the mom in the back in the white. She probably played this as a kid, and she got the moves down. She knows it just like the kids know how to do it, right? She got it. And this is a little bobbly thing for kids, but he probably played it when he was a kid. And a lot of flashy colors on this one. Flashy colors are always cool for these Japanese type games. Now this guy looks like he's really strong. He's like muscle man.
Broken. No. Jeez, I'm gonna pay for that.
This is a game I've never seen before. This is like some cube game where you press different patterns. And it looks really cool. I mean, this Qbert game, it's really, really, really cool looking. Now, these guys are still over here from earlier. I'm telling you, they love this. These games, they love them. They're in it. They keep playing them over and over and over, and they just don't stop. And of course, you can keep playing some of these games forever because they want you to keep putting more money in them, more and more and more money. Some people are into this kind of stuff, and they'll stay there the whole day, a whole weekend. This looks like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles or a game like that. This is a two-player version, obviously. So they had two-player games. They had four-player games. It was really cool. Flaming Finger. Who would name a game Flaming Finger? I mean, really? There's 720. That was one of my favorite games. Just remember, you have to skate or die. That's right, skate or die, baby. Ah, good times. This is looks like a newer monitor. I don't know what this is, but these guys are playing it. And it's like a newer setup that maybe it's a homemade, homebrew kind of setup. Fearless Pinocchio. All right, geez, is that a big nose on your face, or are you just glad to see me? Fearless Pinocchio, really? Your name's like that. Punch Out. Mike Tyson's Punch Out, if you're from a certain time period. And I just remember this. I have nightmares. There you go. Uppercut, uppercut, lower cut, groin cut, uppercut, uppercut, left cut, groin cut, jab. Orlando Solar Bears. They are a minor league hockey team in Orlando, Florida. So I guess this guy is playing Blades of Steel. Oh, yeah, that's hockey. Yeah, baby, I just scored. You know it. Now, reactor. Wait, no. Got enough time in my fancy little Apple Watch or whatever it is. And yep, got enough time for one more game. This looks like Marble Man. Yep. This, it's kind of like a Marble Madness type game, but without the trackballs. Really? How do you play Marble Madness without trackballs? Okay, so if you're epileptic or you don't like flashing, you might, oh yeah, good job, man. You might want to skip forward a little bit because we're going to go through how to train people to become mass murderers, if that's politically correct to say that. So these are arcade games where they have guns. This was an old electromechanical game. I actually remember this type of game, not particularly that one, but I remember it when I was like young, they had one at this arcade. Here's when you have a couple of Uzis, this is a game from Tato. And you just go in there and they're all basically the same, right? You have guys going on the screen and you shoot at them. And so here's one with all the flashing on it. So you might want to like just jump over this for a few seconds here. This is a Atari Games game. This is a big buck hunter, I guess, if you want to like kill animals for some reason. I don't understand that. The worst, toughest arcade controllers ever, Defender. Okay, second worst after the sequel, Stargate, which had an invisible one. But I mean, that's just like an insanely tough game to play. And here's Star Wars, the arcade game, on the way to Firefox. They're both from Atari. Whatever. This is a Laserdisc game, where they had Laserdisc in the background. They overlaid stuff in front of it, because it was tough to do that kind of stuff. Ghosts and Goblins. Ooh, scary. So you go through the jungles looking for ghosts and goblins. I know this. Anyway, this is Centipede. It's one of the best Atari games that came out. It was a fun game. And of course, there was Millipede, the sequel. It's nice to see the guy in the back, because usually it's the opposite. Usually the girl in the back, and she's like, oh, come on, man, let's go. It's nice to see the guy sitting back there holding her drink for a good job. And Monaco GP, oh, man, this was another cool game. See, you look down at like a road, which is kind of novel. Yeah, that's cool. Scramble. Okay, let's see how far she can go. And I'll, all right, she started the game. How far? Boom. First, okay, try it again. Okay, second time. Let's see how far she can get on Scramble. Okay, this time go back and, sorry, NBA Jams. Tournament edition. I still have Nightmares from 1994, some CES, when Acclaim had their stuff. Watch one of my videos about that. You'll have nightmares about that. This is Tempest. Let's see how that guy's hand is over top of the spinner. That's how spinners are supposed to be. You're not supposed to put your hand on the side. You're supposed to over top. That's why spinners are supposed to be smaller, height-wise. R-Type, I played this in the arcade and had three screens. It was really cool. This is the one-screen version they have there. This is Astro Fighter. This shows you you don't actually need to sit in chairs or stand to play a game. This is actually a tabletop one for bars. You put it on there and you can go play because you already have that. Now here's Dragon's Lair. This is where you get to pick the adventure. Wait, what? No, Space Ace. So I guess they must have had a conversion kit where you can have either Dragon's Lair or Space Ace. It's basically the same game on a laser disc, and it's the same. You can just switch it over. Some people do that. Jungle King, or later on Jungle Hunt, is another game. You probably know it from Jungle Hunt because there was a lawsuit and all that jazz. But this was kind of a fun game. It had four screens, if you remember, back in the day. If you went around, you find games like Zaxxon. This is a pseudo 3D kind of looking game where you go through and, hey, we can do 3D. It's not really 3D. Now, Pac-Man. Remember the patterns in Pac-Man? Yep. You had to memorize. Oh, that's not the pattern, dude. I remember what is this? This is the banana? What is this? The fruit? I forget which one. And this guy's like, oh man, I wish I had patterns on this Pac-Man. This sucks. I can get killed. I can only do 8 screens, maybe 12. You over there playing Donkey Kong? Ah, man, you see a lot of that. You see a lot of that. It get killed. It's like, oh man, it's the programmer. It's the game. I'm the best. This game sucks. Then they go back and play it and have a blast. And this is one of the original Donkey Kongs. This is a sit-down version, a tabletop cocktail version. If you take a look, the artwork is a little different than the other ones you used to. And of course, who can forget Qbert? Now here comes Warren Davis, who programmed and designed good old Qbert Arcade.
So tell us about your upbringing and how you got into technology.
Well, I was always interested in computers, even at an early age. And when I was in high school, I was very lucky in that my high school actually had a computer. It was very rare in the early 1970s. But I was actually in charge of my computer lab my junior and senior year. And then when I went to college, my choices were, well, I was interested in computers, but I was also interested in filmmaking. But everybody sort of nudged me to study computers, which was fine by me, so I got a degree in computer engineering, and that's where I learned software. And when I graduated, I got a master's degree in electrical engineering, and then after that, I worked for Bell Labs as an electrical engineer. I kind of became disenchanted with the world of engineering. I felt like I didn't fit in, and I dropped out of my job and I moved to Chicago. I had been working in the suburbs, and then I started learning improv, improvisation, Second City style. So I did that for a little while, but the money was running out, so I started looking at the want ads for engineering jobs, and I found an advertisement in the Sunday paper. Gottlieb Games was looking for video game programmers. Now, video games was something I was always dreamed I might be able to do, and so I answered the ad, and the rest is history. So at Gottlieb, I was hired by Gottlieb, and I worked as a supplemental programmer on another game that was never released, so I kind of got my feet wet, learned the hardware a little bit. But then it was time for me to create my own game. And I had never made a game before, so I kind of wanted to learn a couple of techniques, so I took it upon myself as a programming exercise. I had seen these Escher cubes, a pattern that filled the screen, that was created by Jeff Lee for Kanya Yamamoto, who's another programmer. But when I looked at it, I sort of envisioned that if you carved it into a pyramid, and a ball were to fall on the top, it would have one of two ways to bounce, and that's binary. And programmers like binary. So I thought I could take this time to program binary randomness and gravity. So it was a programming exercise for me, really, and I programmed a ball bouncing down a pyramid of cubes. I didn't have a game, just that idea. So once that was done, people would look at it and say, well, that looks pretty cool. What, you know, what are you going to do with it? And I thought, all right, well, I guess I'll do something with it. So I added a player character, and it turned out player character was this orange ball with a long nose that Jeff Lee had lying around. I wasn't interested. Jeff thought maybe this character would shoot out of its nose, but I wasn't really interested in that. That might have been a little too complicated. So I just had him jumping around the pyramid, and actually every element of the game just evolved until I had a game. After Qbert, I actually made an advanced version of Qbert called Faster, Harder, More Challenging Qbert. That's a whole story. I also made a Laserdisc game called Us vs. Them. But in 1984, Gottlieb was shut down by its parent company, and I actually left the industry for a short while, about a year, but then I was hired back into Williams Electronics to sort of, go back into the video game world. The video game industry had experienced a lull, but it was starting to pick up, and they were looking for programmers. So I worked at Williams, and I worked on Joust 2 as a sort of a co-programmer to finish the game and get it out the door. And after that, I started working on digitized graphics. It occurred to me that our next hardware system was going to be capable of 256 colors rather than 16, and that gave us opportunities to do things that were a little more photorealistic. So about that time, video digitizers were coming out, and I started playing around with those. Anyway, that led to software that allowed live actors to be used and filmed and used in games. NARC was the first game that used that digitizing system. I ended up leaving Williams for a while, and I worked on a game called Exterminator for Premier Technologies. Came back to Williams in the middle of the Terminator 2 development cycle, and worked on the Terminator 2 team, Revolution X featuring Aerosmith. And meanwhile, I continued to develop my software and improving it with faster memory, faster processors, to the point where we had a really robust blue screen studio at Williams, and we could film actors and get them into our game very, very quickly. I left Williams in 1995 and went to California and worked in the home industry. I started work at Disney, making games for Disney. Yeah. So I've been working for about 3 years on a memoir. I started going to retro gaming shows a few years ago, and telling stories about a variety of games and projects that I worked on. Qbert, Us vs. Them, the digitizing system for Mortal Kombat and NBA Jam, Terminator 2, Revolution, so many stories, and I realized I've got to put them somewhere. I'm not going to be around to tell them for very long, who knows how long. So I thought I'd collect them and put them down on paper. So I actually wrote this book. It's a memoir of my arcade game years. I moved into the home industry in the late 90s, and there are more stories to tell. I kind of touch on Disney at the end of the book. But there's a lot of photos. There are rare photos. There are photos from my personal collection. There are papers and documents and a lot of very personal and rare material. So I'm hoping people will enjoy it and people will read it. I actually printed it right now just for Free Play Florida. But it will be available eventually online, and I will take it with me to other shows that I attend. But it's a real exciting thing for me to have actually finished this and be able to hold it in my hand and be able to share it with people.
What's your favorite arcade video game?
Wow.
Just pick one, fast, go.
Us versus Them. That's personal, my favorite.
What's your favorite that you did not work on?
Oh, That's a tough one. There's too many.
Pick some.
Don't put pressure on me, man.
Fast. Lightning round. Come on.
No, I don't do that. I don't do that, man. I'm telling you, there's not one. I can't name one.
What's your favorite sports team?
I don't have one. I'm not a sports guy. Although I got to say, I lived in Chicago for a long time. I kind of love the Cubbies.
Baseball. You like baseball?
No.
Okay. How many millions of dollars did you make from Williams and Gottlieb?
Yeah, I wish, man. I wish. Unfortunately, I was paid well for my time as an employee. And I would say Williams was very generous with bonuses and royalties. Gottlieb did not have a royalty program in place when I made Qbert. They did put one in place. Stories in the book, by the way. But they did put one in place after Mach 3. And they shared that with the company, and they used Qbert as an example, and they said, you know, if Qbert had been made under the royalty program, well, Warren would have made over $100,000 in royalties. But it wasn't, and it was not retroactive. So I have not, you know, made a fortune from Qbert. Many people think I own the rights to the game. I don't. I was an employee. Sony owns the rights, and they have for many years. So, both myself, Jeff Lee, and Dave Thiel, we all three worked on the game. We haven't benefited financially at all from Qbert, but we do have bragging rights.
If you were a superhero, who would you be? And why?
I kind of like invisibility. I like that as a superpower.
Why?
Don't know.
What would you do if you had that power?
I'd move around stealthily.
You wouldn't like knock over a bank or anything? Or?
No, I wouldn't do that.
I would.
Well, okay, now we're getting a little bit about you, aren't we?
So that was Free Play Florida 2019. They do this every year in Orlando usually. And it's usually Thanksgiving weekend. And you get to go there and have fun, video games, pinball, you name it. It's there. They have panels, they have guests, they have just tons and tons of stuff. If you're in Orlando around Thanksgiving time, look it up and come to Free Play Florida next year.